So I know we talked about doing Hestia this week on Wednesday afternoon worship, but my cat's really loud. But as y'all know, it's been kind of a hard weekend for me. And usually, especially when I'm doing like homebrew stuff in videos, those get recorded days in advance. Like I said, the membership video. I'm recording this. I don't have my glasses on at all. I'm super blind. About 3 hours before the video is due. And so, to make sure I can still have something come out today on Wednesday afternoon worship, I wanted to take something that was a little easier to do, something that involved a lot less homebrew. It was then that I realized that there's only one deity on the Wednesday afternoon worship request line that isn't like a god from 3.5, IRL, ancient deity, rune lord, so on and so forth. So that's fun. Anyway, by process of elimination, we're gonna hit Hestia next week. Just sit tight. Thank y'all for understanding today. Let's talk about Nauticula. Of course, there will be homebrew where the homebrew is needed, but again, I really just need to do one where the foundation is laid. Anyway, if you're liking what you're seeing, like, subscribe, ding that bell. Today, this episode of Wednesday Afternoon Worship was brought to you in part not by a single patron, but by all of my patrons who have reached out for me in what is basically a time of crisis. Not gonna lie, I didn't think I had a support group other than like paying the bills. So humbled is the word I'll say, and appreciative. Thank y'all. Okay, enough of the sappiness. Let's get demonetized. Here we go. So Nauticula, it turns out, actually was the very first succubus. She ascended from just being a regular demon to a demigoddess and present day in 1E. Obviously, like we said, and we'll talk about here, she looks a little different in 2E, has her sight set on full divinity. So far, the only demon lord that's been able to accomplish this 100% has been Lamashtu. Some say Nauticula is doing this as a means of seeking redemption. As the chief succubus, basically, even other demon lords are not safe from her deadly temptations. The number of demon lords she's seduced and then assassinated is impressive. Amongst them, the demon lord of shadows, and when she killed him, she won the grudging loyalty of shadow demons, as well as several other competitors for the queen of the succubi. When these rivals were dispatched, shall we say, rather than having their essence merge with the quintessence of the Rift of Repose, her victims' energy and lives formed islands in her realm known as the Midnight Isles, which we 110% will be going to in Wrath of the Righteous. Trying to keep this one as spoiler-free as possible. The Midnight Isles consists of dozens of islands on an immense sea of still black water, and a disturbingly large moon in the sky overhead. Of course, the other demon lords would treat Nauticula with a mixture of obsession and fear. Up until recently, her and her brother Sukhothmanoff had maintained a relatively friendly relationship, at times even lovers. But as Nauticula's power has grown, so has her brother's jealousy. After he betrayed her in a failed assassination attempt, she left him humiliated and broken on the steps before his abyssal domain. And since then, Nauticula has taken pains to ignore him, knowing that that refusal to acknowledge his rage only further makes him angry. As one might imagine, Nauticula is a very popular demon lord amongst the drow, but has worshippers all over the place, which is good because the cult of Lamashtu likes to fight her, seeing her rise in power. She needs all the help she can get, which is splendid because even in first edition, there were rumors that Nauticula were about to gain full divinity. But let's not worry about that right now. Let's worry about some 1E. Of course, the demon lord of assassins, darkness, and lust is chaotic evil. Her domains are charm, chaos, darkness, and evil, with the subdomains demon, loss, lust, and night. Her favorite weapon is the hand crossbow, and her unholy symbol is a seven-pointed crown wrapped with thorny vines. To perform Nauticula's obedience, ingest a dose of psychedelic plants or fungi and engage in any number of sexual acts, either alone or with others, during which at least a pint of blood must be shed. So basically, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, neato. In return, it's a +4 profane bonus on saves against blindness and charm effects. Evangelist boons give us a natural lust, you knew you'd see it here, thrice a day, detect thoughts twice a day, or vampiric touch once a day. You can shape your flesh at 16th level into seductive forms, you hate to see it. You gain the change shape universal monster ability, usable once per day as a standard action, allowing you to take the shape of any small or medium humanoid. Your natural form becomes beautiful and sexually appealing, and you gain horns, a pointed tail, and small wings. While in your natural form, you gain a tiefling's dark vision and fiendish resistance racial traits, as well as a free prehensile tail and vestigial wings. Dang, okay, sure. If you're already a tiefling, you gain a +2 bonus to charisma instead of these additional tiefling traits in any form. It's a +4 on bluff to lie. So if you're one of those alternate tieflings that already had a +2 to charisma, the rich are getting richer. Holy poop, that's really good. At 20th level, like with a succubus, romantic or sexual contact with you can be deadly. When you engage in an active passion, such as a kiss, way to quickly make it PG-13, well done, with another creature, you bestow one negative level upon that creature. You must grapple an unwilling creature to use this ability. Such an active passion also has the effect of a suggestion spell, asking the victim to accept another active passion. The DC of this suggestion, as well as the DC to remove any negative levels, is 10, plus half your hit dice, plus your charisma, which you might have just buffed in-house. You can initially activate this ability only once a day, but once you do so to target a specific creature, you can affect that creature with this ability at will. Flavorful, powerful, terrifying, we've checked all the boxes. Well done. Exalted Boons, it's Charm Person thrice a day, Darkness twice a day, or Suggestion once a day. At 16th level, thrice a day, it's a Quickened Blindness Deafness as a spell-like ability. Definitely not as shiny as some of the other things that we've seen, but like, that's not bad. Once a day at 20th, you can cast Dominate Monster as a spell-like. You can have only one creature dominated at a time via this effect, but the effects are permanent until you dominate a new target, at which point the previous target is released from the domination but stunned for 1d4 rounds. Sentinel Boons. It's Vanish thrice a day, Invisibility twice a day, or Twilight Knife once per day. At 16th level, you get Sneak Attack plus 2d6, which stacks with any other source you might have. Whenever you make a sneak attack against a creature that is aware of your presence and considers you an ally, your sneak attack dice are increased to d10s. This applies to both sneak attack dice gained through this and other things. So yeah, Bluff Rogues, this is where you sign, right here, this is the one. Sell your soul. GG soul. At 20th level, your devotion to Nauticula is rewarded with a single whisper from her lips to your ear alone, revealing one of the countless words Our Lady in Shadows knows to cause death. Each of her worshippers receives a unique word. When you learn it, you can use the word to cast Power Word Kill as a spell-like once per day. Disgusting. Now let's make it even worse. Let's talk about her stats. Yeah, you can fight Nauticula if you want to. She's CR 30, and yeah, that makes sense for somebody who's about to transcend and become a full, true divine being. Something you can't hope to fight, something that you draw a sword against and then just kind of die a miserable death. She's got a lot of crazy abilities, she's got a unique weapon, she's got a billion spell likes. As always, we are just going to talk today about her special abilities and that fancy weapon of hers. First, with Cruel Shot. Nauticula is adept at making ranged attacks to strike cruel shots that deal significant and humiliating damage. Really hitting you where it hurts, I see. She adds her charisma bonus to all damage dealt by ranged weapons. As a standard action, Nauticula can crush a foe's will. The target must be visible and within 120 feet, then it's a DC 43 will save or a caster level 30th dominate monster. If she uses domination against a humanoid creature, she may instead use the ability as a swift action, in which case it's a dominate person. As long as you're dominated by Nauticula, you get a +4 profane bonus on all saves against targets other than Nauticula. So nobody can dispel it, nobody can save you. Oopsie daisies. Nauticula's got energy drain. It functions identically to that of a succubus, except that it's 2 levels when it's used against mythic creatures, or 1d6 +4 levels against the non-myth. So get good or get dead, basically. Both her sting and her hand crossbow deliver poison. Fort save 44, once per round for 6 rounds, it's 1d4. Wisdom drain plus paralysis for a round. If you fail 2 consecutive saves, you're permanently blinded, disgusting, and makes it that much easier to dominate you. Nice. As a swift action, while in an active passion, That was kind of hard to say and sort of poetic. Neat. With a willing mortal, Nauticula may grant a profane ascension. The target's name appears in glowing abyssal runes on Nauticula's wings, and a crimson mark manifests somewhere on the target's body. The target immediately gains a +6 profane bonus to one ability score of its choice and a +4 profane bonus to any other ability score of its choice. So it's a little tiny baby half-fiend template. Neat. And see in darkness. A single creature may have only one profane ascension in effect at any one time. So long as this effect persists, Nauticula can communicate telepathically with the target across any distance and may use any of her spell likes through the target, manifesting them as if the target were using them. This can only be removed by a miracle or wish, unless Nauticula wants to take it back as a free action and immediately deal 4d6 points of charisma drain and impart 1d10 plus 10 permanent negative levels. Be careful what you wish for, guys. That's what I'm saying here. It just might come back to bite you, and not in the way you thought when you first jumped in, but whatever. Nauticula can use her change shape ability as a free action, of course, and unlike most demon lords, she doesn't have frightful presence. Rather, she has a seductive presence that she can activate as a free action whenever she speaks or uses a spell like. Anyone within 180 feet who fails a DC 43 fortitude save loses any immunity to mind affecting, charm, and compulsion, and becomes fascinated by Nauticula for 5d4 rounds, so she shuts off all the psychics immediately. A creature affected by a mind-affecting effect while within this aura remains affected even after leaving the seductive presence. Creatures that pass the save are immune for 24 hours. But that doesn't necessarily make you immune to Shadow Kiss, Nauticula's favored weapon. It's a +5 unholy hand crossbow that magically creates ammunition. Once a target is damaged by a bolt fired from Shadow Kiss, the hand crossbow gains the Bane weapon special ability against the target creature's type on all further attacks. Bolts fired from Shadow Kiss gain the Ghost Touch ability, an effect not normally available to ranged weapons. For that Planar Adventures boon, I think it's gotta be a +2 untyped to Charisma, doesn't it? Before we jump over to 2nd edition right quick, of course Nauticula is pumping out anti-paladins, at least right now, being chaotic evil. And of course, we don't really see a whole lot of much for it now, but sure, let's whip up a quick anti-paladin code, shall we? First and foremost, those who stand in my way or would take what I have shall become stepping stones on my path to greatness. Despite any accomplishments I may have achieved, I will always have my eye on the greater prize. My secrets are my own. I will reveal them to no one. I will prolong my enemy's suffering by any means necessary. Oh, we're not done yet. I guess this one probably won't make the 4 o'clock deadline. Sorry about it, y'all. On a whim, I decided to do a little bit of Googling and see if there was anything in first edition Pathfinder as far as what happens to Nauticula mechanically when she ascends. And it turns out if you get your hands on Midwives to Death, the very last part of Tyrant's Grasp, the very last adventure path in first edition, there's a little bit at the end they're calling a developer showcase. There's a lot of really cool stuff in there. Plant-based haunts, bloodlines, and a couple of deities, up to and including chaotic neutral Nauticula. So let's swing it once again. Little bit of lore. Second verse, much different than the first. I'm literally just going to quote this one as it reads from the AP. Outsiders lack something inherent to the mortal condition, free will. When an outsider is created, it is an extension of its home plane. Whether it's a personification of fire or water, good or evil, law or chaos. Only outsiders born on the material plane can make their own choices and forge their own destinies. Yet, as in any set of rules, there are exceptions, and one of the most striking is the recent rise of Nauticula from the rank of Demon Lord to full deity. No one event triggered Nauticula's rise from evil. For thousands of years, she served as a patron of assassins and a paragon of destructive lust. Yet for many of those centuries, she also served as a potent guard against the proliferation of demonic lords. Her realm in the Abyss was, quite literally, built upon the corpses of demon lords. Likewise, her rise into the role of Redeemer Queen was built upon these corpses, for with each demon lord she destroyed, she gained not only power, but the conviction to turn against her own nature. whether her full-fledged divinity was caused by her final flight from evil, from the evil of the abyss, the cumulative karma built up from the defeat of so many demon lords, or the metaphysical support of mortal believers, is relevant to the fact that today, Nauticula exists as a power of her own, separate from the abyss and no longer a mere demon. Among her first acts upon becoming a deity was the creation of her planar realm, an archipelago of islands extending from the shores of the boundless azure ocean in Elysium into the churning waters of the Maelstrom. This realm, known as the Midnight Palette, is inspired in some part by her prior realm in the Abyss. Yet, whereas the components of the Midnight Isles were formed from the bodies of slaughtered demon lords, the lands of the Midnight's Palette took their shapes from the artistic works of 24 of Nauticula's most devoted worshippers. In time, as her faith grows, more isles will doubtless form from the talents of her faithful. Those who venerated Nauticula as a demon lord find themselves faced with a difficult decision. Some certainly follow their goddess and sought to change their ways, but many have stubbornly refused to give up their love of murder and hedonism, as you do. Those worshippers have gravitated to other demon lords, particularly Shax, Sukoth, Benoth, and Zura. Nauticula's old realm of the Midnight Isles remains under the control of Shimira, who is the most likely candidate to ascend from nascent demon lord to full demon lord and fill the vacancy left behind. Shimira bears no ill will towards her prior mistress, but other demon lords and their cults are eager for vengeance, if only out of fear that they themselves might someday lose their way from the pleasures of violence and sin. The faith of the Redeemer Queen is spreading quickly, particularly through New Thassilon, where one-time Rune Lord Sorshen functions as Nauticula's most powerful supporter. What role the faith has to play in the world at large remains to be seen, but so long as despots suppress artistic integrity, as long as society rejects eccentrics, and so long as those who find nothing to fear from the darkest reaches of the night endure, her religion will only grow, and it's already grown into deific obediences. The Redeemer Queen is chaotic neutral. Her domains are artifice, chaos, darkness, travel, and void, with the subdomains exploration, isolation, moon, night, revelry, and whimsy. Her favorite weapon is the dagger, and her holy symbol is a moon with a pair of smirking lips and a seven-pointed crown. To perform the Redeemer Queen's obedience, spend an hour in a secluded location while crafting a work of art. If your hour of work begins at, ends at, or includes the stroke of midnight, then the subject of your art is up to you. Otherwise, your art must include the concept of midnight in some way. When you aren't adjacent to an ally, gain a +1 morale bonus to your AC and on saves. Evangelist boons, it's vanish thrice a day, invisibility twice a day, or non-detection once a day. At 16th level, once per day, you can make a special touch attack against an outsider. On a hit, the outsider becomes staggered for one round, as it suddenly becomes aware of the fact that it need not follow the ethos and morals of its kind, that it can choose options other than the traditions of its ilk. The outsider must also succeed at a will saving throw, 10 plus half HD plus cha, or become favorably disposed towards you as if affected by charm monster. In this case, the stagger effect persists for 1d4 plus 1 rounds, even if the charm effect is dispelled or negated. Given time, you may be able to convert the outsider from its ways and help it find a new path beyond its alignment, although the GM should adjudicate the time and potential success of such an endeavor. This effect is the equivalent of a 7th level mind-affecting spell. At 20th level, once per day, when you are reduced to negative hit points by damage, you are instead reduced to 1 hit point and affected by a mislead spell. Caster level equals character level. The illusory double created by the spell appears to be your dead body. Exalted boons, it's crafter's fortune thrice a day, wood shape twice a day, or major image once a day. At 16th level, once per day as a standard action, you can conjure an object into existence in your vicinity. Objects created in this fashion are always artistic in appearance, otherwise the spell-like ability functions as major creation. And once per day at 20th, you can summon a construct to do your bidding. This functions as Summon Monster 9, but you can only choose to summon one Iron Golem, 1d3 Stone Golems, or 1d4 plus 1 Glass Golems. That might actually be a summon boon I like. Sentinel boons give us True Strike thrice a day, Cat's Grace twice a day, or Keen Edge once a day. At 16th level, you grow a sinuous tail. If you already have a tail, you grow a second one. Dope. This tail is prehensile and capable of manipulating and holding small objects, but cannot perform the manual work as if it were a hand, with the exception of wielding a dagger. Oh, so a free extra attack with daggers, neat. When you make a full attack, you can make an additional attack with this tail-wielded dagger. When you do so, you resolve this attack as a primary attack, add your dexterity modifier to any damage dealt, in addition to any modifiers you might have from strength, and have a reach that is 5 feet greater than your base reach. Wielding a dagger with your tail in this way does not count as two-weapon fighting for the purposes of determining penalties to attacks made with weapons wielded in your hands. In any round which you don't make a full attack, but you wield a dagger with your tail, it makes a single attack against an adjacent enemy of your choice. If it hits, it deals no damage, but distracts the foe enough so that you gain a +2 circumstance bonus to your AC against that target. You cannot attack with this tail-wielded dagger in any other way, including as a thrown weapon, but holy crap, that's dumb. I love that so much. But it seems to get better. At 20th level, every night at midnight, you gain the benefits of a heal spell and a greater restoration spell, both resolving at caster level equal to character level. Dang. Just dang. I'm really glad I went back to find this, even if it means my video is a little late. That's really, really good mechanically, and also I really like it. It really speaks to Tommy at age like 16. Tommy the musician, Tommy the person who's staying up all night, to speak super frankly, so I would be asleep when my mother was awake. So far as teenage Tommy was concerned, that despot suppressing artistic integrity. Yeah, that's really, really cool. I really like it. I like the art. Nail meathead. Okay, so we're gonna need a second anti-paladin code, clearly. Eventually we'll talk second edition. I know that's the more popular one right now, but I'm a little inspired. You still got anti-paladins here. This is less of a crush your enemies through manipulation. A little more of, I guess, shall we say, like if Callistria and Shaylin had a weird love child. Yeah, that makes sense to me. Okay, new anti-paladin code, here we go. I will protect those who seek shelter in the night. Darkness is full of dangers, but not entirely so. I shall always seek to create art, even if I must do it away from prying eyes. Though my art may never receive appreciation in the mortal realm, it may very well receive appreciation in Midnight's palette. Absolutely no one is beyond being who they want to be. I shall endeavor to help those who wish to change and crush those who would oppress them. There we go. That sounds a little more like something a chaotic evil character would say, right? Though I do not seek isolation, I am not afraid to isolate myself if it would facilitate change. If those around me seek a new home, I will endeavor to make that happen, by force if necessary. And now we'll swing on back, I suppose, to our regularly scheduled video. Again, I'm super sorry, this is gonna be just real late now. We've suddenly tacked like 10 more minutes of content onto this video, but I really like it. This is like 10 out of 10. If I ever get a chance to play this character in first edition again, I 110% will be doing so. Why? Because it reminds me a lot of 16-year-old me, and it kind of also resonates with me today. So, good. I'm glad I stumbled on this. Anyway, back we go! Alright, second edition. Here we go. Like we talked about in the new Thassalon video, present day, in second edition, Nauticula is known as the Redeemer Queen. She's cast aside her former association with Lust and Slaughter to welcome in artists and exiles. Everything else I'm sure we're gonna see really, really quickly, but let's just, real quick, this should be easy enough to brew. Nauticula is now chaotic neutral. Her edicts are, be the person you want to be, create art, and do not be afraid of redemption. Anathema, basically, stay stuck in your old ways, shall we say. Her follower alignments, I'll say, are neutral, and chaotic good. Chaotic evil feels weird for the redeemed demon lord, but I could be wrong. Her divine font is to either harm or heal. Her divine skill is, shall we say, performance. Her favorite weapon now, of course, is the dagger, having recently shed a domain or two. I feel like we're looking at creation, darkness, freedom, and moon. Charm is a first level spell. Suggestion as a 4th level spell, synesthesia as a 5th level spell. Okay, so session zeros are important. If you would like to use this individual in your games, talk about it with your players and GM beforehand, because of course the demon lords are all about things that might be really bad for some people at your tables. Discretion is the better part of valor. We've all seen the consent checklist. I certainly am a fan of it. And you know, when the guy who helped write the Book of Vile Darkness is turning around and putting that out, he might be onto something. In any case, the notion of an evil creature, a creature of abject evil, born of abject evil, that seeks ascension and, in second edition, redemption, brings a lot of really interesting narrative stuff to your world. That doesn't happen often. Matter of fact, a lot of times in my games, it's just right out. Unless specifically somebody said that I am a tiefling who is the child of a redeemed demon, Hachicha, I would not consider it. These are creatures born and molded of absolute good or evil or so on and so forth, and it's really difficult for them to change, but with Nauticula, we've proven that it's not impossible. Such a once-in-a-lifetime, possibly once-in-an-age occurrence is certainly par for the course for a campaign in and of itself. Your characters are secret followers of Nauticula. Knowing Nauticula is trying to ascend, it creates a huge schism in the faith, and it's up to you guys to use your charm, wit, and guile to deal with the problems. If I were to play a character who worshipped Nauticula, I mean a tiefling with an extra +2 on their charisma, looks real good on basically everything. Sneaky, sneaky, stabby, stabby, all the d10s. Mechanically, Nauticula's boons look great, but what do y'all think? Have we worshipped Nauticula? Have we fought Nauticula? Throw it down in the comments, and as always, thank y'all so much for your support. We'll be back at it with Hestia next week. See you then.